Hello friends, so continuing with our series Alphabet of Ethics, today we would be taking attitude and all its constituent. Attitude is basically the second syllabic topic after ethics, okay, and in this series, in this particular lecture we will be taking lots of words, but do not get hampered up, okay. All are simple. First of all, I would discuss the concept that we would be discussing. First of all, we would be taking attitude, then we would be taking attitude versus aptitude, okay. Third, we would be taking component of attitude. Fourth, we would be taking categories of attitude. Fifth is formation of attitude, different theories. Sixth is structure of attitude. Seventh is moral judgment. Eighth is political attitude. Okay, ninth is political ideology, 10th is social psychology and social persuasion, and then 11th is functions of attitude, 12th is social influence, and the 13th is risk theory, one theory given by a particular scientist, 14th is persuasion, how you are persuaded, and 15th is office politics. Do not get like worked up. So many topics, but we'll be taking individually. You have to just focus on that particular topic, okay. See, attitude has been mentioned in the syllabus with a very scientific approach. They are talking about content, structure, formation, thought, behavior, social persuasion, okay. And then in aptitude, when they are talking about aptitude, which we'll be taking in our next lecture, in that they are talking about your empathy, compassion. So syllabus only makes it clear, if you are not aware, ki there is a difference between attitude and aptitude. Attitude is basically inductive in nature, whereas aptitude is deductive. It comes from inside. What psychological tendency you have for a particular object is your attitude, but your inherent potentiality is your aptitude. This is the reason why in CAT examination, which you must be aware of, they in that examination they tell us quantitative aptitude, not quantitative attitude, because basically they want to test your inherent capacity, inherent potentiality to play with numbers, okay. So when we come to attitude, we basically come with three particular aspects. See, these are all psychological tendency which you have developed from the time you were born till now. Every day we are developing, because something is happening, some external things are happening, we are constantly thinking, we are constantly applying our mind and reaching to a particular result. This whole process develops a psychological tendency towards an object. That object could be animate object or inanimate object. Psychological tendency towards an object which could be favorable or unfavorable. Okay, suppose you have seen other lectures of attitude. You see this lecture, you have a particular psychological tendency of your evaluation. Okay, and now if you see this lecture, based on your psychological tendencies for evaluating those lectures, you would basically be appraising my lecture as well. Okay, so what you had before, you basically apply. Okay. So psychological tendency for an object resulting in favorable or unfavorable. Favorable attitude basically results into positive resultant effect, and unfavorable attitude results into negative result. Okay. Now we come to component of attitude. Actually, component of attitude means constituent of attitude. Okay. And component of attitude could be read as CAB. Cognitive, affective with A, AFFECTIV, affective, and behavioral. Cognitive is your thinking, what you are basically thinking about a particular thing. Affective is your emotions, and behavioral is how you behave. It could be related to your thinking or related to your emotion. Giving an example, suppose you bought a car. The three statements of buying a car by you, or you buy a bike, because you would buy a bike only now in your student days. See, I bought this bike because it provided me with a better fuel efficiency, that is cognitive. अफेक्टिव वुड बी आई बॉट दिस बाइक बिकॉज आई रियली लाइक द डिजाइन इमोशंस. एंड बिहेवियरल वुड बी आई बॉट दिस बाइक बिकॉज अर्लियर ऑल्सो आई हैव यूज दिस बाइक डिपेंडिंग अपॉन इट्स फ्यूल एफिशियंसी और डिपेंडिंग अपॉन इट्स डिजाइन. तो बिहेवियरल कुड हैव इशू रिलेटेड विथ कॉग्निटिव और इशू रिलेटेड विथ अफेक्टिव. ओके सो दिस इज CAB. दिस हैपन्स इन योर एवरी डे लाइफ इन ईच एंड एवरी कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ योर लाइफ वेदर यू अप्लाई योर दिमाग यू अप्लाई योर हर्ट और यू एंड दिस ओनली लेटर ऑन डेवलप्स इन योर इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस कि वॉट टाइप ऑफ एप्लीकेशन यू आर हैविंग related to basically emotional intelligence is your intelligence and emotions. Both the words are antithetical, but they have been combined by Daniel Goleman. We will be discussing later on. Then fourth is categories. See, when we discuss categories of attitude, we come to explicit and implicit. Explicit attitude are your self-reported attitude. For the simple reason, because you voluntarily know that you would be having this type of psychological tendency for this particular object. You know that. Okay? Suppose you are a pet loving person. You would have explicitly, you would shower your love even to a street dog. And implicit attitude are basically those attitude which have certain memory related to it. Okay? In forensic psychology, it is said that the girl who had been abused in her childhood, okay, she develops a very negative attitude towards certain conditionalities, towards certain person, or she becomes like highly suspicious. And always remember that explicit and implicit acts as iceberg. Explicit, you are aware, and this only affects like tip of the iceberg. It only has that small context as far as your attitudinal expression is concerned, whereas implicit has that under the water जो रहता है, मतलब 8/9 portion or maximum portion gets affected by your implicit attitude which you have but you are not aware of. Suppose all of a sudden something happens and you just like jerk off, you completely like you get angry, then you decide that why I got angered, because this was a simple thing, but something was there related to that particular situation, something related to your memory or something related to your childhood, and you got angry. Explicitly you could not control because implicit has a predominant role. Okay, then we come to formation of attitude. Actually, in this formation of attitude we have certain theories. Till now we have four theories, but because of increased interest of psychologists in this particular domain, lots of more could be expected. Now we have four theories: classical or Pavlovian, instrumental, observational, and genetic. Okay. See, classical or Pavlovian is basically related to the experiment done by that famous French psychologist Pavlov. There are four different scenario. First of all, he rang the bell. Nothing happened to that dog. Then he rang the bell. Then he second scenario is he gave bread. The dog had that salivation at the sight of the bread. Then third scenario, he gave bread, but before giving bread he always used to ring that bell. Okay. Fourth scenario is he just rang the bell again, but this time because the dog had associated ringing of bell with the subsequent providing of bread to it, it associated that, and just by the ringing of the bell only the salivation process started to function in dog. Okay, we must be aware about this thing every day. Like suppose you are eating in a restaurant, you had ate in a restaurant, and suddenly you because of certain circumstances you had to go to that area, you saw that restaurant and then you remembered and your salivation started because that memory was there, your conditioning was there. Okay, then we come to instrumental. Basically instrumental attitude theory says that this is related to your reward and punishment. suppose a child who had bought a very good result, okay, suddenly their parents started to flower her with lots of praises and appreciation. So that child develops a positive attitude as far as studying is concerned. Okay, this is the reason why in poor society, or which are the parents who are not that much appreciative about studying, the children after a certain age, they develop a negative attitude towards studying, because anyway they are not getting any appreciation. So instrumental attitude works there. Then observational, basically how you observe things and you develop your attitude. Okay, suppose 8 people have bought a flag on 15th of August or 26th of January, which is coming now. You also have that urge to buy flag, though you are not that of a type of a person, but you have that because observational attitude is developing. Then fourth is genetic. As we know, that scientists increasingly have been telling that we are a product of our genes and our upbringing. Okay, increasingly scientists have been telling that lots of our psychological traits, psychological fingerprints, psychological prints, you can call it in that way, also depends upon your genetic factors. Okay, so this is the formation of attitude theories. Then we come to structure of attitude. See, structure of attitude, basically it has three type of the structure of attitude. In this we would be studying three types: the strength, accessibility and ambivalence. Okay, how we have developed this structure? Basically we have come with three concepts, and in each of the concept we would apply component of attitude to come up with a particular context related to that. So when we discuss strength of attitude, it depends upon how strengthful that attitude aspect is. Some of your attitude aspect is very very strong, so you have bilkul black and white approach towards particular thing. Suppose you are a teetotaler, you do not drink, you have a strong attitude. No, then we come to accessibility. It depends upon how much accessible that attitudinal aspect is as far as the memory part is concerned, because accessibility depends upon your memory. How strong that accessibility is, or how direct coherence has that memory with your expression of your psychological tendency. Suppose, again coming to that example, suppose a girl child had been abused in her childhood. Depending upon the accessibility, in some of the girl child, the accessibility is not that strong. Maybe she forgets, or maybe she gets busy in other approaches. But then in some of the girls, that, and this also basically relates to your post-traumatic stress syndrome. Okay, PTSD, which is called as. Okay, the accessibility is very very direct. Okay. Then ambivalence. Here the attitudinal aspect is in the gray zone. You are not sure whether to move in this direction or in this direction. Okay, this also happens. Suppose all of a sudden you have developed a thing that I am growing obese, or maybe my BP is not keeping up. So all of a sudden you start to jog, but then since that there is an ambivalence, because things have been provided externally, you have not basically realized it. Okay, so 4 or 5 days you would go to jogging, then 5th day you would drop it. So there is an ambivalence. You would think that, okay, it's fine, I'm healthy. Okay, so there is ambivalence. Okay, so now we come to the moral judgment. See, moral judgment are basically judgment, as I have told in my previous lectures as well. Judgment could be right and wrong. Judgment cannot be true or false. Okay, so moral judgment is basically related to how you basically judge a particular scenario based upon your moral beliefs. Okay, so it could be right or wrong, it could be good or bad, it could be better or worse. Okay, and moral judgment, again, the foci of that moral judgment is individual. It is not society. So moral judgment would always be related to that individual, and it is not also ordained. It is not like God provided. So supernatural aspect does not work as far as this moral judgment is concerned. Then we come to political attitude. Actually, this particular thing has become very important because of the social networking sites and Cambridge Analytica case that happened, where they had your psychological, matlab, Facebook has taken up data of the people, how they actually interacted on the Facebook, and then they developed a psychological algorithm of you as a personality, and then they started to target you with particular advertisement that you would be liking. Okay, in fact, this social networking site have psychological copy of everybody. Like today, Facebook has become the biggest country. It has like more than 2.8 billion people. It has 2.8 billion psychological prints, you can call it in that way. Okay, so in this political attitude, actually Cambridge Analytica also it also used this political attitude and how it could be actually affected. Okay, there are five different things. See, every person has five attributes. Okay, not exclusively, but they are mixture of these five attributes. Maybe somebody has a particular attribute in a more strong sense, so that person has that particular character. Okay, that five attributes are extraversion, agreeableness, conscientiousness, emotional stability, and openness. Cambridge Analytica used these five. Actually, they basically categorized all of us into particular categories, and then they started to throw that particular advertisement. Micro targeting, it is called as. Okay, extraversion is basically your extrovert feeling, how assertive you are, how better you can speak publicly, how you hold your ground. Go with the words only. Okay, कोई ऐसा technical term तो है नहीं. Agreeableness are people who are basically believe in social cohesion. Okay, they agree, they are mild in nature. Conscientiousness, people are very very conscious about their acts. Okay, they are very conscious. Okay, their puritanical soul, if you can call it. Emotional stability, again, like people who balances themselves out. We will be discussing this topic later on in our emotional intelligence. And then openness is that trait where you are very much open to discuss about your life, to discuss about your feelings, your emotions. Okay, you find also in parties, if you go, like these five traits can be basically juxtaposed on any group of people, and you can come up with their particular trait. Okay, so this political attitude, extraversion, agreeableness, conscientiousness, emotional stability, and openness. Okay, Donald Trump supporters are people who are very very extrovert and very very open. They have less of emotional stability. Okay, they have less of conscientiousness. So this way, they targeted against Hillary Clinton, they targeted those voters with particular type of advertisement. And most of these advertisement which was presented to them as facts were like fake news. Okay, so after this political attitude, We come to functions of attitude. Okay, in this functions of attitude, we come to a particular philosopher named as, actually he was a psychologist come philosopher named as Katz, K-A-T-Z. Okay, he basically said that ab attitude hai to it has also some functionality. And what are the functionality? First is utilitarian functionality. Second is knowledge. Basically, knowledge is again like you have so many information. So knowledge is needed to basically categorize and basically to stack those information in a particular format depending upon your personality. Then ego defensive. One function of attitude is also your ego defensive, because basically you have to defend your ego. Okay, so some of the acts that you do, though it is not coming from your character side, it is only coming from your personality side, but those things you do for your ego defense. Fourth is value expressive. These are your attitudinal tendencies which are value expressive. Basically you give alms to people. So that basically tells something about your altruistic nature. Then we come to social identity. Social identity is again related to how you identify with group of people. Suppose in America, if you go to America, people who are from Bihar or who are from Karnataka, in India, they would not feel that much close. But in America, they feel that, oh, you are from my country. So that is social identity. Okay. So functions of attitude, then we come to social psychology and social persuasion. See, social psychology again is the psychological print of that particular society. Okay, psychology basically again is the scientific study of how that society behaves in a particular manner. Okay, and social persuasion again depends upon how easily or how difficult it is to persuade that particular society. Some of the societies are inoculated. Okay, it is very difficult for a society like Bhutan to sell consumerist approach to that society, because that society is inoculated, that society is vaccinated against consumerism, because they know that nothing basically leads to having 4 mobile or 3 car. Okay, so social persuasion. Then we come to the next topic, and that next topic again is like disk theory. Okay, in this disk theory, this has been given by a Harvard scientist called William Moulton. It has been given by William Marshall Moulton. In this disk theory, he has said that there are basically 4 aspects. One is dominance. I is your inducement. This is your dominant. This is your inducement. This is your compliance. And this is your steadiness. Okay. This is your steadiness. This is your dominance. D stands for dominance. I stands for inducement. How easily you can be induced. S stands for submission. And C stands for compliance. Okay. This also, disk theory also is coming up vigorously nowadays. This theory also says that all the population can be divided into 4 manner. Like everybody could be divided into 4 basic categories. Whether they are dominant, they could be induced, they could be subsumed, or they could be made compliant. Okay. Then we come to political ideology. See, political ideology is basically your inclination to any particular political object. That particular object could be that political personality, political political thinking, political approach, political framing of a particular narrative. Okay, so political ideology depends upon your attitudinal inclination to a particular political object. Okay. Then we come to persuasion. Okay. See, here we have discussed social persuasion. Basically, this is extension. How easily could you be persuaded? Social persuasion, and it has been given by a philosopher called Karl Hovland. C-A-R-L, Karl Hovland. And he said that you can be persuaded as a person or as a society depending upon who, what, and to whom. Who says that message, what that message is, and to whom that message is said. Who, what, whom. Suppose, as in pandemic, Amitabh Bachchan was always, as we received a call or we dialed a call, Amitabh Bachchan was telling. So, who? It was not a common person. What and to whom? Okay, so we all are in awe of Amitabh Bachchan. So naturally, that message could be easily bought by the commoners. What that message was, and then to whom? Okay, so who, what, and to whom? This is the basic fundamental of Karl Hovland persuasion theory. Okay, but some of the time this persuasion does not happen also, and it depends upon whether you are inoculated. Suppose you are a person who are anti-scientist, anti-scientific theories. So whatever those people are telling about your vaccination and everything, you do not regard them because you believe in God. Okay, that is extremist view. you believe in God, nothing would happen. Okay. Whether you have been forewarned. Second is, you have been forewarned. Suppose somebody tells you, "Arey, do not listen to Amitabh Bachchan. He is a big corrupt person." So you basically got forewarned. Then third is stockpile. Suppose you have been seeing lots of news about Amitabh Bachchan, that he is a person whose speech should not be believed in. So you have a stockpile. Fourth is defensive mechanism, your own defensive mechanism, because you are a person who is very cynical. So you have a defense mechanism. So this is again how you can be persuaded, and what are the four aspects where persuasion is not successful. Then we come to office politics. Actually, office politics case study can come. Office politics per se is neither good nor bad, as we have been discussing in this ethics paper. But office politics is also a necessary evil, because office politics basically makes every person, even though he is not engaging in that office politics, this is a very good platform for information exchange. What type of person that is, what type of project that is. So office politics, you should know how to negotiate with office politics rather than damning or dooming it. Okay, then we come to public and administrative attitude versus citizens. Actually, you know, when we discuss this particular thing, actually this is the relevant thing as far as all the things that we have discussed. This is the relevant aspect. See, public versus citizen. How public, how administration perceives those people. One aspect. How people perceives administration, second aspect. And what is the coherence between the two? So administration, basically administrative people, it is said that IAS, newly trained IAS, they are more empathic. Okay, they view public as extension of themselves, but slowly they realize that status quo is very difficult to break. So their attitude changes. Then citizen also, maybe a new SP comes up in a place, and all of a sudden lots of news starts to come out that he is a very nice person, he's a very compassionate person. So lots of people would have a positive attitude as far as that particular administrative officer is concerned. And then third aspect is administration and citizen. In other two aspects, we were discussing versus. Third is, we are basically combining both. That combination is the required expectation. Okay. So we discussed, I think, all of the things that was to be discussed in this lecture. So again, in a nutshell, we discussed attitude and all its various aspects. And we also discussed political attitude. We tried to take that Cambridge Analytica. We discussed social psychology. We discussed persuasion and office politics. Okay. So hope you are liking. This lecture, try to just concentrate on those words. Okay. I hope that you are liking my lecture. Please share the video, and thank you.